For those of you who are in the morning, welcome again. I'm sure this is a much nicer setting than being closeted. Although IIC is a lovely campus, but I'm sure this is a much nicer setting than being enclosed inside a room, especially in this kind of gorgeous January weather. So welcome again. And for those of you who have joined us now in the evening, who could not able to make it for the morning session or for the day session, welcome, a warm welcome to this ACM India Women's session, where we'll have some very interesting talks and hopefully an insightful panel discussion on issues that are relevant to getting more women in computing and computer science research. So without much further ado, I'd want to introduce, I don't know what to call her, but I'll make the formal introductions first. She's the ACM India Secretary. She's also the moderator for the panel, and she's also graciously agreed to be our MC for the evening. May I call upon stage Rashmi Mohan. Rashmi. Thank you.
Okay.
All yours.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the ACMW event at the MSR Academic Research Summit. I'm thrilled to see the gender ratio as it is. I've never seen such a healthy ratio before. So whether it's the food or the coercion that got you here, we're very happy that you are here. You're definitely going to leave with some very, very interesting thoughts and aha moments about your fellow colleagues, women in research, and their achievements. So without further ado, let me kick it off by inviting our first speaker for the evening. I'm surely a very familiar figure to most of you, Kalika Bali, a senior researcher at Microsoft. And she's going to be talking about her area of research, which is natural language systems, and also debunking some myths for us about women in CS research. One thing I have to add, Kalika, please, is she didn't want a formal introduction. So clearly, her work speaks for itself. So welcome, and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Rashmi, and welcome everybody. It's nice to see all of you here. So so I'm going to give a really short talk, and I was asked to talk about my career and life story, etc. And I probably would need a day and lots of beverages and food to go through my entire life story and sob through it. So I thought I'd talk of something different. Having said that, there's something I do want to say. I am not a computer scientist, okay? But for the last 17 years, I've been working in either a computer science lab, R&D, or in startups. So I have spent, except for in the beginning when I was a lecturer in Fiji, I have spent my entire working life with computer scientists. So I think, and I'm a woman, and as I was mentioning to Geeta just some time back, I came to Bangalore to work with the Simputer people, and then I moved to HP Labs to work in their speech team, and we built one of the very first TTS systems in Hindi, which I'm immensely proud of even now, because we were just ahead of our times. At that time, there was no scope for speech services the way you see them now. But we had one of the most, till date, the most natural sounding Hindi text-to-speech synthesis system ever. So when I was there, there were 13 full-time employees in the lab. I was the only woman. And I know exactly how it feels to be a minority, but a very vocal minority. Of course, then in Microsoft Research, we are slightly better, slightly better. I do have other women colleagues there with whom to discuss things. But it's still everywhere in the past 17 years that I've been in this industry, I am always in a minority. And that's something, if we can't change, we can at least try to change and have our voices heard. So when I had to talk about this, I kind of thought, what should I talk about? What would be relevant for the audience here? And I sent out a mail to a lot of my colleagues across Microsoft, across the academia, and asked them to let me know what they thought was the one biggest myth about women in technology. And I came up with a lot of interesting you know, replies to that. So someone said one big myth is that women in technology don't take their technical careers very seriously. And that's a very big myth, that men are somehow much more serious about their careers than women are. Somebody else said that, you know, one of the biggest myths for women in technology is that just be yourself, do your work, and you shall be rewarded. And they said that's not true. You have to do shameless self-promotion. And that shameless self-promotion doesn't mean false self-promotion. It just means that you have to go out there, be in people's face, say what I'm doing is great work, right? You have to do that to succeed, just as the men do. And they said it's a myth that most women believe that, you know, if we're just quiet and we quietly keep doing our work, somebody will notice it and say, wow, you're great, and will, you know, somehow reward us. And that doesn't happen. Then somebody else said that another great myth is, and this is something I think a lot of us, we've heard a lot in various places, so this is something a lot of us will resonate with, and that is, if a woman is ambitious, you know, she is grasping, she is greedy, she is hard, all the negative adjectives, negative sentiments that you can associate with ambition are the woman's. If a man is the same way, he is driven, he's inspiring, he is so motivated. And this is something all of us face. And I think it's really true, even more so true in the Indian context, where we're all constantly trying to juggle this, I'm such a good girl, you know, I'm like this perfect good Indian girl with, I'm a career woman, right? So, and I've seen this happen a lot. The other thing somebody said is that you need, and this is not a myth, I think, this is, according to me, not a myth, but I see their point of view. The other thing they said was that you need a very supportive family to succeed. And this is something that I have very mixed feelings about. Now, here's the thing why I have mixed feelings about this. Yes, everybody needs a supportive family to succeed. I think men do as well as women. Except that I have never seen a man stand on stage and say, I wouldn't have been there if it wasn't for my mother, my brother, and my wife, and my daughter, right? And almost every successful Indian woman I've met who gets to stand on a stage like this and talk to an audience like this says, I wouldn't have been there if it wasn't for my husband, who was so supportive, my father, who encouraged me so much to study and achieve this, my brother, who protected me from the minute I stepped out of the house till I reached college and came back, and my son, who was so understanding of his mother having to go out and work. So you see the dilemma that I have here about women appreciating their family. We should all appreciate our family. But how that becomes a crucial thing. And this is something that comes again and again. I was once part of the audience in a panel where a very senior woman researcher was asked what she thought was the single most important thing that you need to succeed in your career in research. And she said, only half jokingly, marry the right person. Okay? And I was like, what? What message are you giving to the young people here? And then again, a really senior woman stood in again one of these really big events where there were at least 10 times more people than here. And she was asked about her life story, etc. And she kept talking about how supportive her family was. And then one young girl, she must have been like 20, she stood up to ask a question and she said, ma'am, but what if my family is not supportive? What if my husband does not support my career? Does that mean that I'm not good enough? Or does that mean that I will not succeed? And I thought that was a very and nobody could, she didn't answer that, and nobody could answer that. And I think that's a really important thing. And the message I would like to give all people, especially young people, is if you have a supportive family, good for you. You're lucky. I had a very supportive family. I have a very supportive family. And that is definitely a plus point. But that's just luck. And you're being good in what you do, you being a good technologist as a woman is not dependent on your family. That's you. Okay? So before, there's like one more thing that I really want to talk about, and which is like that's one myth that every single person sent me back. And I think it's, again, a really relevant thing, especially for this audience. So, you know, most of us are trying to increase diversity in whichever workplace and group that we belong to. And we have discussions on how to do this and why it's the case that we don't have enough women coming up in computer science and technology, et cetera, et cetera. And one of the things that we have, mostly men, but also some women, say to us is, it's a pipeline problem, you know? We cannot hire more women because there are not enough women in computer science. Or we cannot hire more women in this particular area of computer science, say systems, because not very many women go and do, you know, computer science studies in systems. You know, you have an easier time because you do natural language processing, and let me tell you, I don't. Especially in India, I mean, I work in NLP and speech. Especially in India, there are minuscule people who do natural language processing research. Okay, systems are much more easier to, systems researchers are much more easier to gather. That's not the case. And because a lot of our diversity things are, you know, somehow we kind of take the lead from the West, we really need to understand the difference here. So I believe, from what I've read and what I've been told, that in the West there is definitely an issue of how to get more girls into STEM, have more girls study science and technology and mathematics, and we know that's not the case in India, right? We have no problem finding girls or encouraging girls to go and take up science or technology or math in India. We have a problem getting all girls to go to school and get an education, but people who will educate their girls would want them to do science, right? So that's not the problem. The problem starts at a different level afterwards. And I have been studying, just to refute this myth and to show you what a big myth it is, I've been studying these reports that have been worked by, you know, there were some researchers in ISC who did that, and there have been some government-sponsored agencies which did the report of women in science in academia in India. And I have these numbers, and I found these numbers very interesting. So when the country gained independence, which was 1947, so around 1950, the total number of women in science enrolled in colleges was less than 5%, science and technology. It continued to grow, and in 2000, we have 40% of the enrollments are women in science and about 35% in technology. And that kind of varies. You know, private institutions tend to have a higher number of women than you know, the top tier IITs, etc. And I don't know why that is the case, but you know, there is stats to show that. Since 2000, it's been like static. There's been no change whatsoever, but I think 40% is a very, very good number. However, when we look at women faculty in various institutes, can somebody tell me what the number is? It's less than 10%. And it hasn't grown for decades. There has never been a woman director of IIT, any IIT. If you start looking at the senior positions, the number grows to like minuscule percentages. And I mean, there are faculty members here who were students at one point of time. They're students here. And I want to ask one of you, in all your experience, have you never thought of, like met a woman professor whom you thought, yes, I mean, she could be a director of the institute? What is it that weans these things out? It's not a pipeline problem. We have 40% women graduating, okay? We have a large number, even a large number of percentage of PhDs are women. So what happens? Where does this filtering happen? And in the reports that I read, and I'm just quote, like giving you example of the report, this is not like my own research, so I can't tell you what the credibility of this is. They say it's mostly marriage, okay? Women get married. Women are not promoted because they will get married and have kids, and therefore become less productive. So you can either be reproductive or productive, you know? Those are your choices. Men, of course, have known these things. And they quoted certain numbers for it, which for me were like really funny and eye-opening. So apparently, the percentage of women, unmarried women, is 14% in faculty positions. Of unmarried men is 2.5%. This is the case in a country where the minute your daughter is 18 years old, you start looking for a groom for her. So obviously, this is seen as a big conflict. Again, there are several studies which contradict this. And they say that, you know, if you provide, okay, sometimes women need to take a break from their career to have kids, get married, set up family. That is completely possible. That is a choice that every person should have. But there have been studies which say that if you provide facilities that allow women to not take a break, most women prefer not to take a break. Most women would prefer to continue working if they had the support. So, you know, that's something we should think about. And I would really appreciate, I mean, if anybody wants, they can ping me and I will send you the link of this report. But I would really appreciate if you all went out and tried to burst this myth, at least that, you know, we don't have very many women in technology because not very many women want to be in technology. That's not true. So, you know, this is where I will stop. I think my 10 minutes is well over. And thank you and enjoy.
So it's very rare that you have like such tough, hard messages that are coming out delivered with such humor. I was nodding my head, like, you know, every minute of what Kalika was saying. And one of the things I do want to say when she talks about support and marrying right, I know it's a message that's constantly passed around. I feel it's not so much about marrying right, but it's about the process of education of your spouse through the years that you're married, right? I mean, I know initially, and it's not just your spouse's fault as such, it is the reinforcements that they get from society. Every time I go somewhere, whether it's out with my friends or it's at an event like this, somebody will turn to my husband and say, oh, babysitting, is it? And I'm like, what the hell? I mean, excuse my language, I'm like, he's a parent, it's called parenting. Half of it is his responsibility as well. So in some ways, it is the messaging that goes out. And thank you, Kalika, for that extremely engaging and very, very thought-provoking talk. So next up, I'm going to call somebody who is no stranger to the ACM podiums. Professor Madhavan Mukund, he's a Dean of Studies at Chennai Mathematical Institute, and he's also the president of ACM India. And you must appreciate the fact that he has, you know, battled Jallikattu bulls and walked 6.5 kilometers home to be here with us. So we're thrilled to have you. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Rashmi. So the reason I'm here is because my wife is a computer scientist. But seriously, I think I fully appreciate everything Kalika said, and there's nothing I can say for it or against it that would not instantly, you know, I can plead the Fifth Amendment, as they say. But my brief, I guess, is partly maybe to focus on maybe the pipeline, but pipeline certainly in terms of academic research. So the question is, you know, where are the faculty members? And I think that's what I would like to talk about. So do I see more women faculty members now than I did when I was studying? Possibly a few more. Do I see enough? Certainly not. So maybe one of the issues that has to be addressed is, I think, everywhere, which is to have good role models. I think people need to be inspired to aspire to this. So I'll come to that. But first, I just want to take a quiz. So how many years has the Turing Award been awarded? ACM people are not allowed to answer. Anyone? Take a guess. I mean, you're going to be wrong. I mean, computer science is not so old, and Turing died in 1950s, and they would not have named an award before he died. So actually, this happens to be, I mean, depending on how you count, it's the 50th year of the Turing Award. Okay, so roughly for 50 years, some years more than one person gets the Turing Award. So it's not 50 Turing Awards, but 50 years of the Turing Award. I don't know exactly how many people have got the Turing Award. It's a safe guess. It's probably around 60, 65. Okay, now, how many women have got the Turing Award? So there's an answer here, 3. Is it a guess or is it a... See, this is what I mean, right? So presumably these people are role models of some kind. And people don't even know who they are or how many there are. I mean, it's an embarrassingly small number that you should know who they are and how many there are. So the answer is 3, by the way, right? So it is 3 out of 50 years and 3 out of 60 odd people. Now, so who are the 3? Anybody? Okay, Barbara Liskov, Fran Allen, Shafi Goldwasser. Okay, so Shafi Goldwasser was the most recent woman Turing awardee in 2012 for zero knowledge proofs. Now, what is the good news? If there is a silver lining at all, these 3 have got them in the last 10 years. So maybe there is a changing trend, maybe not. But the point is that, my point is merely that there are clearly not enough role models, and those role models who are there are not celebrated enough. And I think that if you don't have that, I think it's hard to, I mean, my feeling is it's hard to attract people to a profession where they don't have people to look up to and emulate. I also think that coming at academic research as a whole, though it doesn't seem like it, it seems like a cushy job, okay, but it's actually a very risky job. Because research is a very self-driven activity. We don't really have, at least in India, we don't have very well-structured, large-scale research programs where groups of people work together and things happen. So you really have to force yourself to do this research. So if you don't have good role models to tell you it can be done, then it's all the more challenging to take it up. This is just a theory that I have. I'm not substantiating it by anything. But I just feel that there is a certain push which is needed to convince people that this is a risk worth taking, and that's probably it. So it's for sure the case that there are not enough women out of the 40% or 35% who are there in the, say, in the engineering student workforce, thinking of this as a viable alternative. So I don't know the reason for this. This is my explanation. They just don't see it as an option which... maybe there are all the other issues which go with every other kind of career. As Kalika said very rightly, there are myths and there are perceptions and there are real impediments. All these things are there. Nobody can deny them. But in specifically, I just wonder whether it's just such a vanishingly small number. Okay. So the question is, what can you do about it? So I'm not sure what you can do about it except to maybe publicize. I mean, I think we face a general problem in India, if you ask me, about convincing our undergraduate students to take up research. So this is one of our focus things within the community is to try and build up a certain momentum towards research, because most people don't see it as a, I mean, this risk factor is one of them. There are also a lot of social pressures now. I think no person who has a decent engineering degree would be permitted in some sense, unless they have a very understanding family, to go out and waste their time studying more, when you can get what is perceived as a high-paying job immediately after an undergraduate degree. So there's a real pipeline problem in terms of academic research, both male and female, but it's accentuated, I think. I mean, the attenuation is much sharper in the among women students, this thing. Now, what we can do is, like, I mean, I think one can only advertise and invite and maybe be affirmative. So I mentioned in the afternoon to somebody, some of you were there, that we are starting some summer schools this year aimed at inviting undergraduates to come and be exposed to not very high level stuff, but stuff which is beyond their curriculum, which will excite them and hopefully drive them to research. And one of the proposals which we have is, so Aarti would like to have one of these schools in Pune actually exclusively reserved for women students. Maybe these are, I'm not sure if this is the right strategy, but it's certainly a strategy worth trying, right? To try and push people and hope that some of them will stick on is certainly something worth trying. So, I was also told to talk about societal good. So this is something else that I wonder. Now I wonder, okay, so this is again anecdotal, but talking to people like Rashmi and others, my feeling is that in the entrepreneur space, we are doing better in terms of gender balance. Now, I wonder if that is because if you move away from very, you know, academic, technical end use of research, that more people feel that they can contribute. No, there's no doubt, of course. I mean, going back to step one, it is, should there be more diversity? Obviously. I mean, it should not be just diversity in terms of gender, but in all spheres. So there was a nice keynote talk at the ACM annual event on Saturday by Armando Fox, where he put up this picture of one of the women, celebrated women scientists, a computer scientist called Margaret Hamilton, who was head of the MIT software engineering lab, which basically built the software for the Apollo space missions. So not only did she invent, apparently, the term software engineering, but there was this nice group photo of the lab, which had an amazing mix of both genders and, you know, racial types, and it was a complete, you know, heterogeneous group of people. And his point was that you need, I mean, research is a creative activity, and everybody brings from their background a different energy to this activity. And obviously, if you mix more people with different backgrounds, the overall impact is likely to be better. So we need people from all backgrounds and all types of thinking to take part in this. There's no doubt about that, right? So if I can remember where I was, yeah, so now society, yeah, so societal good. So I'm just wondering whether if the avenues for doing research, as they seem to be now, like we heard this had great session in the afternoon about impact on agriculture and water and all these kind of things. So if people can see, as the entrepreneurs are doing now, that the thing that they do has an impact in a wider sense, okay? You're not just, you know, solving a very technical problem to do with pipelining in your CPU or something, but you're doing something which has an impact on society. Maybe this might be a way to get a wider group of people interested in understanding these problems and joining the community. So I don't know, but I think that this might be one aspect which might drive this inclusiveness of research a little forward. But it's a hard problem. I don't have a solution, but all I can end with is that it needs to be addressed. And these are gatherings where we have people who are in the community who need to put together their ideas about how to do it, and hopefully we can all together make a difference. Thank you.